Hello everyone, my name is Brian Zane, and welcome to the first edition of Wrestling With Wregret. On this series, I take a look at some of the strangest, the silliest, and the stupidest things to ever occur in a wrestling ring. Sometimes in wrestling, a gimmick will come along that seems so destined to fail, so goofy and stupid, yet somehow endures and thrives. More often than not, however, a wrestler with a unique look or style will be brought in with so much hype and hope, but ultimately falls by the wayside. Today on Wrestling With Wregret, we take a look at a rare case. A case of a gimmick that seemed so goofy at the onset, but somehow did better than what the parameters of the gimmick seemed to allow. This is a gimmick that could have been great. He could have been one of the best bad guys of all time. But one slip up led to a monumental downfall. I'm talking about Muhammad Hassan, one of the most controversial characters that WWE ever cooked up. In our paranoid, racist, post-9/11 society, it took a lot of balls to bring in a Muslim character to shake things up. It played on our patriotic, anti-foreign sentiment as Americans, and it worked like a charm. But just when the character was seemingly about to hit its stride, Hassan was erased from WWE, never to be seen again. How did it happen? Let's find out. Muhammad Hassan was first introduced via a series of pre-taped vignettes. Whereas most foreign heels in wrestling are booked as immigrants coming to American soil, Muha's character was unique in the fact that he was billed as an Arab American, an honest-to-goodness U.S. citizen.
I went to the same school, I ate the same food, and there was never any animosity between us.
But Hassan and his sidekick Daivari had grown angry with their home country after they and their people had become persecuted by his fellow Americans following the attacks on 9/11. Hassan officially debuted in December of 2004, interrupting a Mick Foley promo.
Because it is our brave men and women.
Do you hear that? What is he singing in that song? Sounds almost like alien, you know, foreign, different, weird. Wonder what they're implying.
And I used to blindly support this country. Right up until 9/11.
If you paid attention to Hassan's promos, you would know that 9/11 was his go-to talking point. I don't think there was a promo in which he didn't mention it. Can you imagine how he would fare in a news conference environment?
Mr. Hassan, why do you think you're being treated unfairly by your fellow Americans?
9/11.
Mr. Hassan, do you think it's at all unfair to judge the entire country as racist against Arab Americans?
9/11.
Well, this person's useless. Mrs. Griffin, what do you have to say about all this?
9/11.
Hassan spent the next several months interrupting people with his awesome entrance music, winning matches, and getting some of the biggest heel reactions seen in some time. It was cheap heat, since it was just a spin on the old anti-American gimmick, but there was nothing else like it going on at the time, and it worked to perfection. They gave him the camel clutch for a finishing move, which I thought was a little cliche. It seems like every Arab or Middle Eastern wrestler gets that move, as if it's something handed down through generations, just because it has the word camel in it. I think they missed the boat on giving Hassan a really memorable finishing maneuver, you know, something with pizzazz, something with character, I don't know, got something like...
Hassan Chalk!
There you go. As was par for the course during this era, you can't have a new guy coming to WWE without stopping at the corner of Mid-Card Feud Boulevard and Jerry Lawler Drive.
I'm gonna propaganda your face with my fist, do you understand that?
Hey.
But instead of propaganda-ing each other in the face like Lawler promised, the four men squared off in that most epic type of rivalry ender. A debate!
I remember a time in this country where people would at least pretend to be polite.
Then came the YouTube comment section.
You people used a national tragedy as an excuse. An excuse to let your real feelings towards Arab Americans come through.
You know, I was gonna hold off on this little factoid until the end of the review, but it's just something that I can't keep to myself any longer, okay? Muhammad Hassan, the guy playing Muhammad Hassan, is Italian! That's right, Muhammad Hassan was actually a wrestler named Mark Capani, a wrestler of Italian descent, who they just gave a spray tan and a Muslim headdress and called him Arab American. Was there really no one better who was an actual Arab American available? Now granted, Capone did a great job with this gimmick, and with the tan and the facial hair, he actually looked the part. But giving the white guy an Arab character is like, I don't know, taking a white guy and making him black. Oh, I'm gonna shut up right now.
Are there racists in this country? Are there? Absolutely. But I got news for you, Hassan. There are racists and idiots in every country in the world.
Yay, idiots and racists? Ross and Lawler took the high road during this exchange, trying to explain that racism wasn't the factor in why fans booed Hassan and Daivari. Hopefully, others within WWE would use Ross and Lawler's level-headedness and logical reasoning as examples of how to properly engage in dialogue with Muhammad Hassan.
I see sand people.
Or, you know... As you might expect, this character provided some of the cheapest of cheap heat you could imagine. But it worked! It was political, it was racial, it was religious, but above all, it was compelling and it kept the fans interested. It played on the real-life emotions of Americans, and who knows, it might have even made people rethink their feelings toward Arab Americans. This had the potential to actually go somewhere. There were even rumors that Hassan was being considered for a main event angle for the WWE Championship. Then... this happened. Fast forward to the summer of 2005. The Undertaker, that silly gimmick I mentioned at the beginning of this video, well, he was still around. And he was scheduled to fight Hassan at the Great American Bash pay-per-view, which would have been a huge highlight for Hassan's career. But a couple of weeks before the big event, the dead man wrestled Daivari. Hassan's sidekick was quickly disposed of. Then it got interesting.
What the hell is this?
Two guys in masks!
Wait, what the hell is going on?
Oh no. Oh dear.
What is that?
Oh no. Oh, like a steel, God, like a steel wire?
I don't know what it is. It's some case choking out Undertaker over it.
Oh no, this is bad. So Muhammad Hassan, the Arab-American, non-terrorist wrestler, hires a bunch of thugs in ski masks to assault The Undertaker and choke him out with piano wire. Then, Hassan prays to Allah before blocking the camel clutch on him. Nope, no terrorism implied here! I'm gonna get to why, on its own, from a gimmick standpoint, this was a completely stupid idea. Now, first of all, had this aired on any other day, it probably would have gotten some flack, but it would eventually would have died down, no harm, no foul. But this didn't air on just any day. This aired the same day as the London bombings of 2005, a real terrorist attack that killed dozens of people and injured hundreds more. The scene was taped on July 4th. The bombings happened on July 5th, and the show aired just hours later. WWE did air an advisor on the show in the US and Canada, but it was not enough to make fans happy. WWE received so much backlash from viewers and the network that any future plans with Muha and Daivari were immediately scrapped. Hassan didn't appear on television again after that segment, and was quickly disposed of by The Undertaker at the pay-per-view.
Not this already! Oh, oh no! Hassan up high! You gotta be kidding me! Stop this!
No! Hassan was given his last ride out of World Wrestling Entertainment, never to be seen again. Anyone can do an Arab terrorist gimmick in wrestling, okay? It's cheap, it's easy, it's the Japanese or the Russian or the German wrestlers back in the old days, just now updated for the 2000s. It's easy, anyone can do it. It's the same thing as if you have an American uber patriotic wrestler as a good guy. It's the same level of cheap heat, but it's just on the opposite end of the spectrum, good versus evil. But with Muhammad Hassan, WWE had their cake and they ate it too. They got the cheap anti-Arab heat, but he was still an American, not some oil tycoon or terrorist. It was an evil foreigner character without being evil or foreign. You can understand why Hassan was upset at his fellow Americans, and it was just him and Daivari doing the fighting, and that was fine. But when you add a bunch of guys in ski masks who, though they didn't say were terrorists, sure gave off that impression, you totally kill what makes the gimmick unique. That segment alone was pretty bad, but the fact that it aired the same day as a real-life terrorist attack that killed lots of innocent people, and that they didn't pull the segment from the show, or even have the decency to make a proper apology for it, made it even worse. Mark Capone was totally screwed by this angle. When you do something as controversial as an Arab-American in a post-9/11 society, then you should expect from the beginning to get a lot of flack, especially if you're the guy playing that character. Now, down the line, you can be repackaged as many ways as you want, but everyone's gonna still remember as you being Muhammad Hassan, that guy. I mean, kind of apples and oranges here, but look at Terry Taylor. He's never going to live down the Red Rooster gimmick, and that brought more terror to fans than Muhammad Hassan ever did. And what's worse, in the case of the poorly timed terrorist attack on The Undertaker, Capone was only doing what he was told to do. He was doing his job, and when shit hit the fan, WWE threw him under the bus. Capone's wrestling career was over after Hassan was killed off. He has since retired from wrestling and has reportedly gone on to live a relatively normal life. But one can only wonder what might have been if WWE hadn't pulled the terrorist stunt. Would he have won a title, been released after the novelty wore off, debuted for TNA as Saddam Khamenei or whatever the hell they were going to call him? I guess we'll never know, but the gimmick was just so unique and compelling, they could have gotten a lot more mileage out of it than they did. Well, I'm Brian Zane, and this has been Wrestling With Wregret. If you have any suggestions of what you think I should review, send your suggestions to wrestlingwithwregret, that's with a W, at gmail.com. I'll see you next time. America.